the first part of Minding Our Language, we looked at the historical roots of the Scots language and how it made it over here to Ulster. In this programme, we'll be concentrating on the rich and varied catalogue of Scots and Ulster Scots literature. But first, I know the programme's only started, but I reckon you need to be insulted. One area where the Ulster Scots language excels itself is in the insult. It has it down to a fine art.
Your body's as lazy as shock water.
His yin's laid off and the other's sliding.
Now you might say you don't know any Ulster Scots, but if I was to call you a slaked gulpman or a carnaptious skitter or a blithering packle, you'd be upset.
Maybe it's not very good at positive affirmation. A lot of the terminology is negative.
In fact, Ulster Scots has so many words, I can give you over 25 insults beginning with the letter G.
Gatherall. Gam. Ganch. Gabberline. Geek. Get.
A lot of the terms are derogatory, but at the same time, they're colourful.
Glump. Glunter. Clunter pudding. Go up.
If you're talking about a slicked out arge for a woman, it'd be very hard to capture or convey that in English.
Gormit. Gornigal. Costrin. Geister.
It's hard to be as effective in English. English has got a much more stilted vocabulary for really offending somebody.
Gulpin.
Great.
Hallions. At the start of the 18th century, it looked like Scots in its written form was in terminal decline. But then something remarkable happened, and it all started with this man. Alan Ramsay's Tea Table Miscellany in the year 1728 was a collection of rural folk poetry and works by Ramsay himself, which did much to spark a revival of interest in the language. And it featured a poem from William Starrett, a man from Strabane.
He sent this verse epistle to Alan Ramsay, who responded to him, and both of those poems are in Alan Ramsay's book. William Starrett's Ulster Scots is very dense, very musical, very lilting, and very definitely not English.
Ramsay's work encouraged the likes of Robert Ferguson. Ferguson loved Edinburgh, and his poetry was gritty and urban.
Aldrichy, which is in the Wailuilka tune, which means the best town in the world. You know, it's the choicest town. The Wail is the choice. Wailuilka tune, choice of every town. It's a celebration of Edinburgh itself. Everything about it's worth celebrating. And Aldrichy means the smoke. This really is an approach like James Joyce. Celebrate a thing, everything.
Now, Ferguson, in turn, was hugely influential on Scotland's most famous son. No, not Billy Connolly. No, not Mel Gibson. Robbie Burns.
When the Robert Burns wrote this, is the Robert Burns committee room of the Scots Parliament.
Is there a room in Scotland not named after Robert Burns?
Well, I tried to find them when I was First Minister and changed that, of course.
Robbie Burns is everywhere in Scotland. Even the hotel we booked here in Stirling. Burns stayed here in the year 1786. He was upset at the run-down nature of Stirling Castle and so scratched a poem on the second floor window of his hotel bedroom. The poem bemoaned the loss of the Stuart line and insulted the Hanovers, who had taken over the British crown, describing them as an idiot race who know them best, despise them most. Realising that this could be quite offensive to some and possibly dangerous to himself, Burns came back to the hotel a couple of months later and smashed the window. By the way, please don't try that at the Europa. Now, I'd like to say that our crack team of researchers working on this programme knew about this story before they booked the hotel. But I can't. No, it's the only hotel in Stirling that would have us. Now, some people are a bit sniffy about Burns and all that wearing of kilts and addressing haggises, but Burns is worth more than a second look. He's celebrated globally. He's a hero in Canada and Russia. There are Burns societies all over America. Bob Dylan claimed inspiration from him.
And if that's not a good enough reason to read them, well, Jeremy Paxman hates them.
Started writing about 13, 14. He was really taken by one of the girls who was helping him on the harvest, Nelly Kilpatrick. And he thought he'd try his luck, and he wrote a song for her called Handsome Nell.
Right.
So that was his first attempt, really, at what he calls the sin of rhyme.
My love is like a red, red rose that's newly sprung in June. And I will love thee still, my dear, till all the seas gang dry. Very romantic. But to be honest, Robbie used to say that to all the girls. Not to be crude about it, but when it came to his love life, Robbie Burns had a wee touch of the Russell Brands.
Ye jovial boys who love the joys, the blissful joys of lovers, ye dare and fell with dauntless brow when the bonny lass discovers. I pray draw near and lend an ear and welcome in a freighter. I've lately been on quarantine, a proven fornicator.
In his lifetime, Burns was known as the ploughman poet, which makes him sound like a kind of rapping poldark.
Mind you, Robbie took his shirt off even more often than poldark.
Well, he had lots of relationships with different women. He fathered at least 13 different children.
13?
Yeah.
By how many women?
Five, that we know of. Initially, Burns published to raise money to go to the West Indies. He thought one last roll of the dice would be worth a punt, and it worked.
The Belfast Newsletter was the first paper in Ireland to print extracts of his work. And the first edition of Burns' poetry printed outside Scotland was printed here in Belfast.
Burns, interestingly, didn't profit from that. So it was in the
days... the Belfast people kept the money? They wouldn't be like us.
It was in the days before copyright.
Now, when Burns wrote in Scots, he often had a glossary at the back of his books translating the Scots words into English. In Ulster, however, the glossary remained, well, unread, unthumbed. Why? Well, because everyone here perfectly understood every single Scots word.
If you look at Tam O'Shanter, for example, Burns' masterpiece, entirely written in Scots, and right in the middle of this rollicking Scots-written ghost story, there's a couple of stanzas in English, but pleasures are like poppies spread. But he puts that couple of stanzas in just to demonstrate, listen, if I'd wanted to write in English, I could have done. I just didn't.
But besides the romanticism, the descriptions of rural life, and the love poems, there was one other key aspect of Burns's later life.
Scots wha hae wi Wallace bled, Scots whan Bruce has aften led, welcome to your gory bed or to victory. Now's the day and now's the hour, see the front of battle lure, see approach prude Edward's poor, chains and slavery.
Scots wha hae is ostensibly about Bannockburn, but its firebrand language is also about so much more. Scots language was the language of the dispossessed and the marginalised, and through Burns it was now clearly identifying itself with the cause of Scottish nationalism.
Burns's increasingly nationalist and revolutionary stance lost him many friends in the establishment.
He was an advocate of the French Revolution in the early days until they threatened Britain with invasion. He followed the American Revolution as well, the Wars of Independence, very keenly. I think Burns was an agitator, really, but he had to watch himself because towards the end of his life, he worked for the Crown. He was an exciseman or taxman. He had to balance his political views with the need to make a living.
And as the government clamped down, well, even the people's poet got a wee bit scared. Scots wha hae was published anonymously. And Jeremy Paxman hated him.
Jeremy Paxman said that he was a purveyor of sentimental doggerel. I wouldn't have minded that opinion, but it was in the preface to a Chambers dictionary, so it was a bit naughty of Chambers to do that, I think.
So he's not welcome here?
Yeah, I'd love to show him around.
Just charge him double. There were poets in Ulster writing in Ulster Scots before Burns burst on the scene, but there's no doubt he took things to a different level and popularised poetry. He was a massive influence on the rhyming weaver poets of the late 18th and early 19th centuries. The rhyming weavers were a new breed of Ulster Scots writer. Many of them were self-taught. They were politically radical. Some of them were involved in the 1798 rebellion. Their poetry drew on the landscape that surrounded them, but was also irreverent and deeply egalitarian. Of course, in those days, the poet was a bit of a star, someone to look up to, and the rhyming weavers were kind of like the X-Factor stars of the 1800s. Except, of course, that the rhyming weavers wrote their own stuff, and were quite good. Mind you, some of the stuff they wrote might surprise you.
Every walk of human life is contained in the poems, if you look deep enough to get them.
Robert Huddleston certainly dealt with the earthiness of human life. He has written one particular poem, The Clergyman and the Schoolmaster, and yes, it does deal with some very untoward goings-on. Two wives and the two husbands, the clergyman and the schoolmaster, had no families, had no children, had failed. But after a few of these encounters in the bar, all of a sudden the children were blossoming, and he suggests that if you're having problems in the farmyard with your hens and your roosters, perhaps just a little bit of
mixing and matching
animal husbandry is required, yes.
So, yes, long before Ashley Madison, Robert Huddleston told us that adultery was alive and well here in Moneyray. Yes, Moneyray, the Bangkok of County Down. Not many people about today. Must be all indoors.
Francis Boyle lampoons this very fancy doctor who comes to Donaghadee and pretends to be very wealthy and respectable. But it turns out that what he's doing in Donaghadee is he's taking care of the ladies of the night who are there, attracted by the sailors here in the town. It's kind of like the ancient version of a Twitter mob. You know, if you want to lampoon somebody and Twitter didn't exist, the local poet was the man that you went to.
Forget statues and awards. You know you've made it when you've got a pub named after you. In 1951, the great poet John Hewitt got a Master's in Arts at Queen's University when he wrote a paper on the weaver poets of Antrim and Down. The remarkable thing is, when he submitted his paper to the academics and professors, they genuinely thought he'd made the whole thing up. None of them had heard of these Ulster Scots poets.
So they made him take them down to the Linhull Library, take them to Central Library, take them to the newspapers collections and actually prove that these existed.
And so they thought that he'd literally was spoofing his load and had made all this up?
As is often thought nowadays as well.
James Orr was one of the finest writers in Ulster Scots that there ever was. Orr was a member of the United Irishmen. He was an on-the-run. He was also a Freemason and a self-taught poet of extraordinary ability and humanity.
He produces pieces that are very, very finely crafted as anything you'll find, you know, in the best of English or Irish literature. He never lost his radical principles. He's very, very clear about the dignity of the ordinary person, and that really comes through in the Irish courtier's death and burial.
Scorn nay, poor man, wha bears oppression's load, nor meanly cringe for favours fae the prude. In a short sentence, serve both man and God. Say, when your clay lies mouldering in a shroud, your soul shall soar to heaven, and care nae mair be clued.
Earlier on, we visited the multi-million pound Robert Burns Museum. Burns's birthplace cottage has been beautifully restored. And this is what James Orr gets. Not so much as a blue plaque on the outside. I mean, come on, even Daniel O'Donnell has got his own museum.
We should be shouting Orr's reputation from the rooftops. A writer of his calibre who has produced work that reflects a period that's key, absolutely key to Irish history, the Rebellion Union period, and gives us a unique Northern Presbyterian perspective on it. It amazes me that he's not on the exam syllabus.
Everyone watching this programme has heard of Seamus Heaney. But hands up, who's actually read lots of his poetry? And no, I don't just mean that you know that line when hope and history rhyme. Who's read lots of them? Don't worry, I'm the same. Most of us are. Most of us don't actually read an awful lot of poetry. But thanks to this programme, I've actually read quite a lot of James Orr. And you know what? He's bloody good. He's funny, he's political, he's clever, he's a brilliant observer of human life, of people, and their foibles and flaws. Orr had a couple of flaws himself.
Because he didn't have a wife to come home to and a happy family, he was inclined to seek company at an inn and just, you know, got too fond of the drink and of the company of drinkers as a result of that. And he seems to regret the amount of time that he has to spend with people like that.
Wouldn't be the first to do that now.
No.
Carol said to me, Tim, whatever you do, please do not call James Orr the George Best of Ulster Scots poetry. So I won't. All I will say is that when Ballycarry finally gets the airport it so desperately needs, there's only one contender for the name.
See you not yon hills and dales, the sun shines on sea.
Burns's poetry led to a temporary resurgence in the Scots language. But Burns died in 1796, and by the early 1800s, the language was suffering neglect and marginalisation.
The Walter Scott Memorial is the biggest monument to any writer anywhere in the world. Though, to be fair, Geoffrey Archer's not dead yet.
Now, Walter Scott spoke in broad Scots, but he wrote in English. The only time he ever wrote in Scots was when he wrote for rural or working class characters. And that really kind of sums up the position of Scots in 19th century Scotland. A man who speaks Scots in everyday life writes in English, because that is the only way to get published. By the middle of the 19th century, Scots and Ulster Scots was being actively discouraged in schools. The Education Acts in Ireland and Scotland confirmed that English was to be the medium of all education. All books and all lessons were from now on to be in English.
A certain snobbery that came in with the education system suggested that Ulster Scots was just bad English, and so for that reason people were writing in English instead.
If I used a Scots word in polite company, my mother would tell me off. So I might say, I'm going out. She'd say, no, you're going out. So she would tell me off with that.
She thought, if you spoke Scots, you'll never get a decent job like running the Robert Burns Birthplace Museum.
Little did she know.
By 1940, the Scottish Education Department stated, Scots is not a language of educated people anywhere and could not be described as a suitable medium of education or culture.
It meant that school wasn't much fun for the average Scots speaker.
People were made fun of, at school particularly. They didn't have their culture or their language respected, and it was very, very damaging for people. People came out the other end feeling unhappy, uncertain about their culture and uncertain about their speech. It shut people up. It shut people up.
I think anybody who grew up in the country would have that sort of experience. My mum tells me about kids who were literally chased around the classroom with the teacher with a cane because they weren't speaking properly.
It was the same as the prescription of Gaelic. It wasn't quite as savage, and it would depend on individual teachers. And of course, a lot of the teachers spoke Scots. I mean, they were free of these towns and all the rest of it. But there was this idea, no, you have to learn to speak English to get on in the world. There was no concept of bilingualism.
People's culture, which had stretched back centuries, their language culture stretching back centuries, treated with utter contempt.
Given the hostility of the establishment to Scots and Ulster Scots, it isn't surprising that the literature went into decline.
Scots literature's almost on its knees because nobody is using the Scots language to tackle big subjects. The people that followed Burns, they followed the kind of countryside, the couthy side, the wee Scotland. There's a lovely poem, wee, a nice wee word, and Scots too, what makes you proud?
But suddenly, everything changed. In 1926, Hugh McDermott wrote a poem called A Drunk Man Looks at a Thistle. And come on, who hasn't done that?
A Drunk Man Looks at the Thistle, it begins with an attack on the Burns cult, the way that this incredibly revolutionary living poet has been turned into a kind of mummified house god.
I was opposed to certain ideas that were current at that time, promulgated by the Burns Club of London, and I decided, in consonance with my own character, to take a very different angle of approach.
Goose London Scotties, with their braw-shirt fronts and all their fancy friends, rejoicing that similar gatherings in Timbuktu, Baghdad, and hell, nae doubt, are voicing Burns sentiments o' universal love in pidgin English, or in wild fool Scots, and toasting in was nocht to them, but an excuse for feathering genius with their thoughts.
MacDiarmid's real name was Christopher Murray Grieve. He was a communist and a founder member of the Scottish National Party. He was also probably the greatest Scottish poet of the 20th century, and he wrote in Scots.
A drunk man looks at the thistle was like a child birth in church. The shock that suddenly... But this is not just a wee dialect. This is a language. This is a modern language.
Almost single-handedly, he dragged the Scots language from its folksy rural cul-de-sac and put it centre stage.
I certainly wouldn't be writing the kind of poetry I have written if I weren't a Scottish nationalist and a communist.
However, even the genius of MacDiarmid couldn't prevent the decline of the Scots language.
As television dominates, the world becomes interrelated, then it is increasingly difficult to defend accents, languages, against that power of uniformity. Interestingly enough, Burns thought that in the late 18th century. So the fact that we're still going strong in the 21st century is probably a compliment to the robustness of Scots.
In the 1998 Good Friday Agreement, all the parties agreed that Ulster Scots was part of the cultural wealth of the island of Ireland. And the UK government has formally recognised both Scots and Ulster Scots as languages under the European Charter on Regional and Minority Languages. Yet, controversy still remains as to the actual status of Ulster Scots, and efforts to protect and promote the language have led to criticisms and problems.
I can see why people have been uncertain about some of the production of material that's come out of some of the agencies that support Ulster Scots, because I've seen them and I'm kind of looking at them thinking, but I don't know what any of this means. Maybe it's because I'm not from that community, but I suspect people in the community are maybe looking at this stuff and wondering the same stuff.
I remember getting a phone call from a neighbour that got his single farm payment documentation from the Department of Agriculture through the letterbox, and there was reams and reams of an Ulster Scots. And this guy was an Ulster Scot and enthusiastic about the language. But in typical canny Scots fashion, in a time of financial austerity, he saw this as being a needless waste of money, because sure, everybody knows and understands English.
What Ulster Scots does attract, or the notion of Ulster Scots as a language, is a kind of payroll vote from certain sectors. One of those sectors is unionist politicians, and in a way it's a kind of shibboleth.
When people who speak the language see these documents and they read these words, they think, well, that doesn't have anything to do with me. What's that about? Why are they doing this? Who are they doing it for? Now, these are sensible and perfectly reasonable questions for people to ask. Why shouldn't they? It's their money that's being spent.
So, is it a language that needs laws and bilingual translations, or does it just need a wee bit of encouragement and education? Well, you'd have to be a politician to decide that, and apparently they're a bit busy at the moment.
We need to stop the bickering over language. One of the things that amazes me is that we're still not teaching children in schools Ulster Scots. We don't have the textbooks, and we don't have a GCSE in Ulster Scots. So that's the stuff to focus on. I have no problem with people translating stuff and putting it in ads, but that's not how you revive a language.
Mark, there are some people who are sceptical about Ulster Scots. Give them a few ideas of where they would really enjoy Ulster Scots literature.
Definitely have a look for Ballads of Down by George Francis Savage Armstrong. Great stuff. And have a look at things by John Clifford or by W.G. Little or Archibald McElroy.
Somebody like Charlie Gillen talking about whenever all the farmers knew the names of individual cattle, right through to buying a second-hand computer or commentating about the rituals of courtship.
This doesn't involve Tinder then? This is kind of a
Tinder? That's something you light the fire with?
I'd like to see an Ulster Scots version of that. All languages are different. As somebody once said, a language is just a dialect with an army and a navy. Who knows if they'll get an army and a navy in there? But as we've seen, Scots was the language of the monarchy and the government of Scotland. And while it certainly was similar to English, it was also distinct as well. The same way Norwegian is similar to, but distinct from Swedish. Speaking to a number of Scots language activists, certainly there's an underlying nationalist agenda. They spoke about respect, esteem, about culture being valued. They say Scots was the way their grannies and their cousins spoke, and it doesn't deserve to be mocked or derided. They don't speak that way just to get a grant. So what implications does that have for the Ulster Scots?
What would you say to people in Northern Ireland who say, look, Ulster Scots, I don't need it, it's not part of my life. Why should we bother paying money for it, for instance?
I would say to these folk, do you really want your bairns and your grandchildren to lose this heritage? Everything that's been written in Ulster Scots, the way that Ulster Scots expresses the reality, Ulster, do you want that just to be lost forever as a living force? Because there's no need for it. It's not very expensive. You just stop correcting the children in the classroom. You encourage the children to use these words.
There's something very soothing, something unique, something lilting and musical in it, you know. It makes me feel my Scottish ancestors. There's just something very hamely about the hamely tongue.
It's really important to hang on to distinctiveness and personality and accent and language wherever you can. We should nourish and protect this, because it's what makes life worth living. There's a richness about the Scots language of which few can be surpassed.
It's part of your own identity. And if you're always just speaking a kind of computer language, where are you? Who are you?
The programme should be called Minding Our Languages, because all the languages spoken here, all the Indigenous languages, English, Ulster, Scots and Irish, they're all our responsibility and our duty to support and to promote and to protect them.
You can't insult a language. It's a thing, it's inanimate. It can't answer back. Dictionaries aren't going to fly off a shelf and attack you. So when you mock Irish or Ulster Scots, you're basically mocking those who speak it, who learn it, who value it and enjoy it. Which means I probably have a few apologies to make. Now, I doubt I'll convince everyone that Ulster Scots is a language. I'm not 100% sure myself. But let's take the politics out of it. I hope I've shown you that even if you think Ulster Scots is a dialect, it also has proper linguistic roots. It has a history and a literature, and therefore it deserves some respect. And besides that, well, it's something that's just a bit of crack. Crack, by the way, is a Scots word, not Irish. But that's another programme entirely.